Hello. Morning. Namaste. We're going to be doing a little series on the Vedic gods. There's a lot of various interpretations that are offered around gods of the Veda, especially the Puranic ideas, which are a much later development. Tend to view the Vedic gods in a very different light. So what we're going to do is go on the basis of discoveries done by Sri Aurobindo, in are documented in his Secret of the Veda, around the Vedic gods. So why bother about the Vedic gods at all? Of what relevance or utility are they to us, right? So if you think about it, the Vedic period, especially the Rig Vedic period, if you take the dates from the time when the Saraswati was in spate, right? Was in sort of flooding, the river was in full flow. According to recent hydrological studies, you're looking at a period easily 8,000 BC, or more, right? I can get to the precise dates later, but that's the sort of period in antiquity that we are looking at, right? So people in these times were not dumb. They were not, semi-animal. Civilization didn't step in, or civilization didn't happen just with the progress of technology or science. Man has been inquiring about his place in the world, about himself, what puts him to sleep, what wakes him up from sleep, where does the dream come from? Where does the impulse to move, to act, to speak? Where do all of these issue from? Well, these have been questions that mankind has been asking for a long, long time, right? Whether through poetry, through art, through inquiry, this investigation has been going on for a long, long time. Now, the Vedic rishis too indulged in some of these inquiries over a long, long period, right? And they stumbled upon or made very significant discoveries. And these discoveries they formulated, they sang about in the Veda. They basically sang in the mantras, what they found out, right? Now I know that there is this contemporary view, or even the traditional view, that the Rig Veda constitutes the book of works, as in karma kanda, right? As in you do this ritual, you get this thing, and so on. Now, Sri Aurobindo says that the Rig Veda is not that, and notwithstanding the opinions of the old masters, Shankara, Madhva, Ramanuja, pretty much every one of the big boys of the Indian spiritual tradition. They all, including Vivekananda for that matter, right? Swami Vivekananda. They all considered Rig Veda to be the book of works, and hence not of much relevance, and the utility of the Vedic corpus lay in the Upanishads, right? Where all these discoveries, all these grand discoveries that the rishis found out were formulated on a more mental language. That's the Upanishads for you, right? Now, so the Vedic rishis, as I said, found out a lot of things. The Puranic view, is a much later development about the Vedic gods, and more often than not, they have something of the idea that the Vedic rishis had of these gods. But more often than not, what you find is a is, I wouldn't say a degradation, but a development, you know, because they had to factor in the more recent discoveries and so on, right? So, in this series, we are going to be discussing the Vedic gods, just an outline, so that, you know, it doesn't get too boring or anything. And much of this material is from Secret of the Veda, whatever I'm going to share with you, written by Sri Aurobindo. And in the process of our self-development, in the process of us pursuing the yoga, there's been more light sort of shed on what these deities represent. Now, these ideas that come from personal experience is the result of the yoga, not by my effort, by any far means, by the grace of Sri Aurobindo and the mother. So that's what we're going to share, right? So we hope you would stick along for the journey. If you have questions, feel free to ask. So let's begin, right? The very first deity, Agni. Right? The Veda begins with an invocation to Agni, right? The very first deity. Now ask yourself, why is there no Ganesha here, right? What happened to Ganesha? Because it's the tradition that every beginning has to be done under the auspices of Ganesha. He's the, you know, lord of beginnings, remover of obstacles, and so on. And the Vedic Rishi has no idea of Ganesha. You know, Ganesha is not yet there. That discovery of that particular power has not yet been made. We are looking at a time in antiquity that's far, far away, right? I mean, there's no history books that can take you there. There's no archaeology that can take you there. There's only the Vak, the word of the Veda. That alone remains through countless minds trying to remember it, realizing it within themselves, and so on. So it's to Agni that the first invocation goes. And what is this Agni? And the Vedic Rishi says, he invokes Agni, and I'm just, you know, remembering and paraphrasing this from memory, right? Agni is asked to come and aid us as the priest of the journey, right? He says, you're the priest of the journey, right? Now, let's take the two words, priest and journey. So what's happening here, right? Agni, popularly known as fire, right? Or the god of fire, or fire itself, right? In popular Hindu tradition. And the Vedic Rishi is calling Agni as the priest. Priest of what? And priest of what sort of a journey, right? Now, here there are some fundamental ideas, right? The Vedic Rishi, who sort of found this mantra, you know, had this particular realization, sees his entire existence as not incidental. He sort of posits a basic hypothesis, right? And the hypothesis is that I'm here and I have to travel somewhere, right? And travel where, right? And to the Vedic Rishi, the travel was not moksha, right? Though the moksha idea, again, is a much later development, and the specific understanding that the Vedic Rishi has of moksha, or the idea of liberation, is very, very different in the Rig Veda, even as compared to the Upanishad, leave alone any other modern notions of what moksha means, right? So there's the journey. So as I said, journey to where? You know, the Vedic Rishi conceives of Swar, heaven, right? As a place and as a part of his consciousness, something that is yet dormant, and he believes, he knows that it's possible to attain that state of consciousness, to open up that layer within himself. And to this journey, he invokes the presence of Agni, right? And he says, you are the priest of the sacrifice. What do you mean? Why a priest of the sacrifice? I mean, right? And here you get a clear sense of the symbolism of the Veda, right? The symbolism of the Vedic Rishi, where he is always talking in dual or triple terms for a given word. So Agni, in this particular case, is not only the fire that's sitting, consuming the sacrificial offerings in the Yajna Kunda. Not only that, Agni is also the will, the aspiration within him that's burning within his heart, that's burning within his mind, that is leading him forward, right? That's leading the human soul forward in its journey. Now, that is Agni. And it is to that Agni that the Vedic Rishi offers his prayer, he offers his invocation, because he knows that the journey is long. The powers of falsehood and darkness are many. He knows that the journey is grueling, and he has but one lifetime to pursue this as of now, right? And he invokes the aid of the god who's the most mightiest of them all. And why mighty? Because in this night of ignorance, so it's not the literal night, right? It's the metaphorical night. The metaphorical night of ignorance in which we live our life. And in this night, it is the aid of Agni that is paramount. Because as the Rishi says, he is the priest of the journey. He is the one who leads you forward, right? So when this aspiration takes birth within us, we clearly see that suddenly we are led to choose one act rather than another. We are led to align in a certain poise rather than another. And oftentimes than not, we do not know where this impulse comes from. You know, there's something within us which chooses, and it is this something that the Vedic Rishi found to be the key determinant, right, of what takes him forward, of what guides him and leads him in his aspiration. And this principle, the Vedic Rishi called as Agni, right? We'll get into more details of what Agni means later, and what Agni is, what are his functions, etc., etc. But for now, the key point that I would want all of us to take away is to remember that Agni is aspiration. It's the will. And it's not the human will, it's the divine will, which manifests within us, which leads, which guides, and which sort of imposes some sort of harmony in our quest to find what we are all about, to find the divine. In whatever name, shape or form that he chooses to reveal himself or herself to us. And it is in this quest that the Rishi asks for the aid of Agni. So that's very brief introduction. We'll probably pursue this in detail in subsequent sessions. Thank you. Namaste.